Greetings, students. Today we're going to discuss the final practice exam. Let's begin. Question one, find the distance between the points. So when we're doing distance again, we're finding the change in y and the change in x, just like we do with slope, except we're having it underneath of a root and mean squared. So I'm asking here, the x's here, how far are they apart? Well, to get from negative 3 to negative 4, we had to decrease in value by 1. And to get from negative 5 to negative 4, we also had to do an increase in value of 1. So our distance here will be equal to the square root of 1 squared plus 1 squared. 1 squared is, of course, 1 for both of these. So our answer is the square root of 2. Now that first value was negative 1 squared, but when a negative squares is a quantity, it becomes positive anyways. So our distance is our square root of 2, because 1 plus 1 is 2. So let's sit here and think for a second. What would happen if this was a negative 2 and this was still a negative 4? Well, then these would be negative 2 apart. So this would change this into a negative 2 squared plus a 1 squared. So our distance would be 4 plus 1 would be 5. If this was like a 0, and then this is negative 4, this would maybe be negative 4 part. So this would be 16 plus 1, we squared a 17. So again, your distance as the numbers change, as the number increases and decreases in value, your distance is going to change accordingly. All right, next question. Simplify the root, the square root specifically. So here we can use a factor tree approach, or we can use a perfect roots approach. So my perfect roots are the square root of 4 becomes a 2, square root of 9 becomes a 3, square root of 16 becomes a 4, square root of 25 becomes a 5, square root of 49 becomes a 7, square root of 36 becomes a 6. So I'm going to take the perfect root approach. What I'm going to look at this, I'm going to look at this and say it's either 4 times 40, which would be uncommon for a student to say that, or I'm going to say it's 16 times 10. Now the 10 is not particularly the part that I was looking for here. The 16 was, because the 16 becomes a 4 when it square roots. So again, I'm not particularly looking for any numbers that go on to 160. If I'm doing the perfect square roots, I'm looking for particular numbers. 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, 81, 100, 121, 144. Numbers that square root evenly to become integers. So square root of 16 becomes a 4. Now the square root of 10 is not reducible here because it's 2 times 5 and neither of those is a perfect root. Neither 2 nor 5 is a perfect root, so 10 will not reduce further. So that's one option here. The other option again is to break this down into all of its corresponding primes. So 160, when it breaks down lots of different ways, but let's say you decided to use a 2, 2 times 80, you would see that this 2 goes in fact, multiple times. Each pair of these 2's comes out as a 2 in the front. So there's a 2 in front of the root. So this would be 160 the same as 2 root 40. Then I got another pair of 2's here. So there's 2 times 2 with a 10 inside. And then the 10 is, of course, 10 times 2, but then I don't have a pair with a 2, so I just have a single 2 left over. So there's the other option here for breaking down the root. You would have a pair of 2's, another pair of 2's, and a 10 left over underneath the radical. And each pair of those 2's comes out as a 2 from the root, because the square root of 4 is 2. All right, question 3, Pythagorean theorem. The hypotenuse squared is equal to the sum of the legs squared. Again, you need to consider which ones are in fact the legs. 6 and 7 are the legs. So I'm going to take 6 squared plus 7 squared here, which will equal value of x squared. 36 and 49 is equal in value to x squared. So x squared is equal to 85. X is the square root of 85. And again, if this one reduces like the last one, you will have to reduce it as well. In this case, it doesn't though. Doesn't reduce the 85, it becomes a 5 and a 17, because 17 times 5 is 85. All right, next one, Pythagorean theorem. identify if it's acute, right, or obtuse by the Pythagorean theorem. Doesn't say to use the Pythagorean theorem here, but that's how we identify if a triangle is acute, right, or obtuse, based on its side measures. Not on the picture, but the side measurements. So 12 squared plus 12 squared, I'm asking if it equals 15 squared. Well, each of these 12 squared is 144. 15 squared is 225. So this is 288, which is bigger in value than 225. So because the hypotenuse is smaller in value than the legs, this is an acute triangle. Because the hypotenuse is smaller in value than the legs. Now, if the hypotenuse is larger in value than the legs, then it's obtuse. And if it's, of course, equal in value, then it's a right triangle. So to make this into an obtuse triangle, one of these side lengths, one of these legs, would have to decrease in value. And the amount that it would have to decrease, it would have to be less than 9. Because 9 squared is 81, and 81 and 144 is 225. So if it was a 9, one of the legs here, then this would be a right triangle, perfect right triangle. Any number less than 9 on one of these sides, with the other side staying as a 12 and the hypotenuse staying as a 15. Anything less than 9, so for example 8, would change this into an obtuse triangle, where the hypotenuse would be larger in value than the legs squared. All right, question 5 is also Pythagorean theorem. So again, I'm asking the same question here as I am on number 5. Asking it in a different way. So does 6 squared and 7 squared, does it equal 10 squared? Well, 36 and 49 compared with 100. 36 and 49, that's 70, 85. That's less than 100. So this time the hypotenuse is longer. So this triangle is obtuse. I'm not asking if it's obtuse. I'm just asking if it's equal, however. So this segment is not tangent. Segment AB is not tangent to the circle. If it was tangent, then that would be a right angle. Angle A would be a right angle. So it would be the side squared, the sum of the sides squared would be equal to the hypotenuse squared. So my answer here is a yes or no type answer. So no, not tangent. So these first 5 questions all have to deal with the Pythagorean theorem. The distance formula is another variation of the Pythagorean theorem. On the distance formula, we're finding the side length of the right triangles, and that'll give us the diagonal, the distance between the points. So all 4 of those kind of function the same way. I did group most of the test questions by what they're related to. Moving along. Question 6. Write the equation of the circle. So x minus the h value, 10 squared, plus y minus the k value, negative 5 squared, is equal to the radius squared. We do have to write out the finished items here still, but that is our starting format. X minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. So this becomes x minus 10. So in other words, the x minus 10 doesn't change, but the y changes into y plus 5 because minus and negative becomes a plus, and the 3 squared changes into a 9. That's the format for equation of a circle. How do we remember the format? Well, point-slope form is basically the same thing. Remember, point-slope form of a line is y minus h equals m times x. Y minus k equals m times x minus h. So point-slope form and equation of a circle have very much to do with each other. And when you're working with either form, the number inside the parentheses next to x and next to y is the x and the y value the opposite of the x and the y value in either point-slope form or an equation of a circle format. And this will also apply to other conic sections when you get to those, if you do get to those later on in your schooling. All right, next items. These next 2 items have to deal with complementary and supplementary angles. So B is adjacent to the 99. So therefore, it will be supplementary because it makes a straight line. So I'll take 180 minus 99 to get the value of angle B, 81. Here, B is also adjacent to the 37, but this time it's 90 degrees because it makes a right angle. It makes a corner, in other words, versus this one, which makes an entire line. This one only makes a corner. So here, it will be complementary, 90 minus 37. These are meant to be quick questions, these two. They're not meant to be longer. All right, question 9 and 10. Arc measurements and lengths. So final length of segment indicated. So this is x, this is 13. I'm asking, is x equal to 13? Well, 13 is in fact the radius of this circle, and x is in fact also the radius of this circle. So x is in fact equal to 13. Not a trick question. Next one, measurement of GD. Well, GD here, if I'm looking at this, GD is the arc from G to D. This arc. And it's equivalent to this arc, E to F. GD is equal to EF. You may have to do some addition here on the test as well. So I may ask you, instead of GD, I may ask you, for example, like GDE, where you'd have to add in this length, this arc here as well. But this arc here, you do 180 minus to find it. 180 minus 125 is 55. So if I did ask you for GDE, you would do 125 plus 55, or you'd just say it's a semicircle, it's 180. Or if I ask you for FGE, you would do 125 plus 55 plus 55. But because I asked for GD, it's the same as EF on this diagram. These are both 125 degrees. Then they're both arcs corresponding to a central angle. So the angles inside here are also 125. Which we're going to get next to, we're going to get to next and then the next page. So I'm set up the next page here. Give me a second while I tape it down. As I've discussed in class before, one of the main issues with this material is practice, practice, practice. So if you are not practicing this material, do not expect to do very well in the finals. All right, so continuing on, central angles are equivalent to their corresponding arcs. So the arcs on this circle along the perimeter will add up to 360, and so do the central angles. So this is not a trick question, x is 53. And again, that's not the same as inscribed angles, which I have underneath. So just as we'll move underneath here and talk about this right now. The inscribed is half of the corresponding arc. So when it's on the edge of the circle, like this x here, the angle I'm looking for here is on the edge of the circle or along the perimeter. That is half of the corresponding arc versus being equivalent when it's in the middle. Central angles are equivalent arcs. Inscribed angles are half the corresponding arcs. So here it's 86 divided in half, 43. Don't get them confused. It's very easy to get them confused for the test questions. Next is on number 11, on number 12. I have the same setup, just to have an x with the 115. So this x plus 115 will equal in value to 107. Again, it's a central angle. If it was an inscribed angle, I'd have to double the x plus the 115. And before I set it equal. Anyway, this is a central angle, so I subtract 115 from 107, and x is in value negative 8. The value of x is negative 8. All right, moving along to the next one there. That's also an inscribed angle with an arc. So I have the arc labeled as 190. The inscribed angle is half the corresponding arc. So again, I'm going to divide this in half. Now, on the test, I did do one of each question, so I kind of mixed this up on the practice here by having both of these becoming inscribed angles from the arcs. On the test, one of the questions is having the arc of the inscribed angle become the arcs. You're going to have to double this value to make that value. So do keep that in mind, that one of the test questions is going to work backwards here, where we double the inscribement to become an arc. In other words, if this angle inside was labeled, for example, If this angle inside was labeled with a 50, the corresponding arc that goes with this would be 100 degrees. It would be 2 times 50. In other words, just keep that in mind for the test. All right, moving right along. Question 15. Here we have the corresponding arc angles on a circle. So the outer angle is half the difference of the inner angle. The the difference of the two inner angles. So I do find this missing internal arc here first, arc AC. And I find arc AC by doing 360 minus the given arc, 245. So arc AC is in the value 115 degrees. The angle outside, and this is not an inscribed angle, this is an exterior angle, is half the corresponding difference of the angles inside, 245 minus 115 divided by 2. So this value x is half of 130, which is in value 65 degrees. All right, here, the angle here, this is not a central angle because these angles are different, 50 and 210, but the angle here is half of the sum of the two angles, of the two arcs. So this is very similar to the question before it. Here we're adding on the one before it, we're subtracting the two given angles. So half of 260 is 130. That is the value of x, 130 degrees. All right, so in order to remember these questions, you do have to practice them. So practice. You can set up your own examples with this. You can get on Khan Academy and go work through his examples with this exterior angle and with this interior angle here. And again, this angle is not inscribed here. It's not along the edge of the circle. And this angle is not inscribed. It's not along the edge. This is an exterior angle. And this is an interior angle. Non-central interior angle. All right, next one, lengths of chords. So 7 times 8. Where'd I get the 7 from? Well, should have been x. X times 8 equals 9 times 16. Notice here that 8 goes into 16 evenly. So if I wanted to save myself some time, I would take 8 into 16 and then multiply it by 9. If I don't want to save myself some time, as I said before, I'm going to allow you to use calculators. I can take 9 times 16. I can get the value of 144 and divide that by 8 to get the same answer. 8 divided by 144 is still 18. All right, next one. The outer length times the entire length are equal on this exterior setup. Again, exterior setup. But this time I'm asking for side lengths. And this is again because of similar triangles. So this triangle here is similar to this triangle here. They have similar lengths. Right, so 9 timesing by x plus 9. The outer length is 9. The whole length is x plus 9. Is equal in value to 7 times by 7 plus 11. Oh, let me get the lights. They turn off if I don't stand up often enough. All right, so this is 9x plus 81. And then 7 times by 7 plus 11. Is 49 plus 77. Or it'd be 7 times 18. 126. You can do it either way. All right, taking away 81 from that would be in value 45, so therefore x is 5. All right, so again, the outer length times the entire length are equivalent for that setup. Permutations and combinations. So P is when you just multiply the given numbers, the amount of numbers that you're using, that you're picking from the group. So this is 5, pick 2. So we pick the first two numbers from 5. 5 and 4 multiplied together. 5, pick 2 is 20. Now this is 11, choose 6. So we take the first 6 numbers from, or 10, choose 6. We take the first 6 numbers from 10. 10 times 9 times 8 times 7 times 6 times 5. There's the first 6. Divided by all 6 of these ones. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Or in other words, 6 factorial. Again, you can do some reduction here if you're doing this by hand. So 6 and 5 will reduce out. 4 times 2 is in fact value. It is in fact 8 in value. So I can make that reduce out as well. And then 3 goes into 9 3 times. So I can save myself some effort here if I want to and change a whole bunch of things around to get the 210. My answer. In other words, 21 times 10. Because 3 into 9 is 3, and 3 times 7 is 21 times 10. I did show you this on the calculator. 10 underneath the probability option. There's an NPR option and an NCR option. Select the NCR over here on the right. And we're using 6. So I did show you this on the calculator. I should put a 6 there. But that's why it gave me an error as well to verify your work. Don't become dependent on the calculator. But I do want you to know how to use it and how to check your work with it. It is useful, and you will be using it next year for most of your work. Or we'll be able to use it for most of your work next year. All right, I'm going to second set the next page. In terms of the test questions, again, I told you in class already, but I'll tell you again now. I want you to listen to this. The test questions are all, the final exam questions are all from our exams this quarter and last quarter, fourth and third quarter. I was allowed to make my own final this year. So I just took all the exam questions and compiled them together, changed the numbers around, of course, so that you wouldn't know what the answers are going into the tests. But the questions, you do know what the questions are. They're the same questions that we've been doing. They're not unique. Anyway, so a state of each scenario is a permutation or combination. So this is just stating the scenario type and then doing the possibilities. So from the 12 people, they're taking the elevator. I'm going to use a group of 6. So from the 12, I'm going to take 6 from the 12. And the question is, does the order matter? Well, no. I mean, it's going to be the same 6 people if I pack them in. If I pack them in the first 6 or I pack them in first 6 in the backwards order, as long as I'm taking the same 6 people in the elevator, the order doesn't matter which six I pick. There's no positions here. So this is 12C6. Again, you can do 12 times 9 times 8 times 7 times 6 over 5, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1 to get this number, which will be equal to 924 in value. All right, find the probability. There are 4 nickels and 5 dimes in your pocket. You randomly pick a coin out of your pocket, then return it to your pocket. Then you randomly pick another coin. The first coin's a nickel and the second's a dime. So I'm taking 2 coins from my pocket, 2 fractions. It's a combined event, so I'm going to multiply those together. I could have done this way on the last one as well. I'm taking 6 people, so I could have had 6 fractions multiplied together here on this last one as well. And the coincidence that I can do this one with NPR and CR setup as well too. I just do these more efficient ways, what I tend to do. So anyway, so the coins, 4 nickels and 5 dimes. So there's 9 coins in my pocket for the first draw. Now I'm going to ask myself on this question, am I returning the coin? And it says right here, return it to your pocket. So for both draws, I'm having the same amount of coins in my pocket. I'm not keeping the coins, I'm putting them back in my pocket. I take the coin from my pocket and I put it back into my pocket. So I want the chance the first coin is a nickel. So that is 4 and 9. And the second coin is dime. Well, that is 5 and 9. And then the product of 4 and 9 and 5 and 9 is 20 and 81. This is another good example of independent events, where the first probability doesn't affect the second one. In other words, where none of the items are removed from sample space between the events. All right, question 23. The mechanic is working under a car, requires 4 different sizes of wrenches from her toolbox, which contains 13 different wrenches. So from her box of 13, she's going to take 4. So reaching for her toolbox, she grabs 4 of them at random. Wants the probability the mechanic has all the wrenches she needs. So this is, again, combinations, because it doesn't matter the order she chooses them in. The wrenches here, as long as she gets the 4 that she needs. The 4 wrenches that she needs is the ones that she needs. It doesn't matter if she chooses a wrench that's 5/8 first or if she chooses the last, as long as she gets the 5/8 wrench. Anyway, so I'm going to do 13C4, and I'm going to get 715. So this is the number of ways that she can reach into her toolbox and grab four wrenches. And it asked me for the probability that she's going to get the four that she needs. Well, that's one in 715. And the reason it's one out of 715 is because there's only one way for her to draw all four wrenches. She's got to draw all four wrenches that she needs. Now, if there are multiple ways that she could draw all four wrenches she needs, then we'd have another NCR on the top here. But that's not the case. And again, I can work this with fractions. I would just have four fractions. The first one would be out of 13. Second one would be out of 12, and then 11, and 10, because she's drawing wrenches from her toolbox one at a time. And then we'd have 4, 3, 2, and 1, because she'd have 4 to choose from at the start, then 3, then 2, and 1, because she'd have to draw all 4 that she needs. All right, moving along, question 24. Probability of A, probability of B, probability of A or B. Again, mutually exclusive events should add together. So I'm asking here, does A plus B, does it? Not stating it does, I'm asking if it does, equal in value to A or B. So does 3/10 plus 3/5, 3/10 plus 3/5, not 3/10, 3/5, 3/10 and 3/5, does it equal 9/10? Well, 3/10 and 3/5 is in fact an equal in value to 0.9, because 3/10 is 3 out of 10, 0.3, 3/5 is 0.6. This is in fact an equal in value to 0.9. So yes. These events are mutually exclusive. So in other words, none of the items in A are also in B, because when you combine the probability together through addition, A plus B is equal to A or B. None of the items in A are in B. In other words. And the word format of this, question 25. A litter of kitten consists of one gray kitten, one gray female, two gray males, two black females, and one black male. You randomly pick one kitten. The kitten is black or female. So can the kitten be black as well as female? Is there a black female? Well, let's look at the question. There's one gray female. There's two gray males. Oh, there's two black females. Two black females. So this is not mutually exclusive because the cat can be part of both of those groups. There is a cat or a kitten that is black as well as a female. So the answer to this question is no. This is not mutually exclusive. There are two cats that are black cats as well as females. They're black female cats. All right. 26, independence versus dependence. So again, independent events is when you're putting the items back, when you're not keeping the items, when your first probability doesn't affect the second probability. So I'm looking at this question. A cooler contains 13 bottles of sports drink, 4 lemon lime, 5 orange, and 4 fruit punch. You randomly grab a bottle, then you return the bottle. Then you return the bottle. So this is independence. I didn't keep the bottle, I didn't drink the bottle, I didn't give it to my friend. I returned it to the sample space before I selected my next bottle. If I had kept the bottle, or if I'd given it to my friend, or if I'd drank the bottle, this would be dependent events. Independent. I did not keep the bottle, or drink the bottle, or give it to my friend. All right, slope-intercept form, y equals mx plus b. We practiced this in class. We did it. You did it last year. It's one of the things I told you you needed to master for geometry, so we're testing on it in the final. The b is the y-intercept, so this b is this value right here on the y-axis. It's a y-value, so that is negative 5. So y is equal to something times x minus 5. The m is the slope, which again you do your slope by counting an upward and up and downwards motion on the line segment. So if this is negative 5, I can count up to the next point here. It goes up 3 and left 1. So that is a negative 3 over 1. Now why am I saying it's negative 3 over 1? Well, because it's going left 1. Now why do I have the negative in the top and not the bottom of the fraction? Well, because the denominator of fractions should never be negative. So I am going left 1 here. I'm going up 3 and left 1 from my y-intercept to my point. But we always write the denominator of fractions as a positive value, so I'm having it as negative 3 over a positive 1, which is the same as positive 3 over negative 1. That's the same number. They're both negative 3. It's just a different variation of the number. And because the test is multiple choice, you do have to match it as this. Negative 3x minus 5, not 3 over negative 1 times x minus 5. All right, point slope form. So y minus the y value. The y value is that, 4, is equal to m times the quantity x minus the x value, negative 5. So this is y minus 4 is equal to, in value, 0 times x plus 5. Now that's going to be 0 right there, because 0 times anything is 0. However, on the final exam, the slope's not going to be listed as a 0 here. It's going to be listed something as a 4 or something like that. So if this was something like a 4 or a 3, then there would be a number here, and you'd have that as your finished answer. But because it's a 0, I can actually just write this as y minus 4 equals 0. I'm actually going to change this right here so it'll better mirror the test questions. Let's change this into an 8. So that way it mirrors the test question better. This would be the finished answer in point slope form. If that slope was an 8, y minus 4 is equals 8, times the quantity x plus 5. Point slope form of a line. Again, that's very similar to the equation of a circle. Anyway, so this is the first two pages, questions 1 through 28. How many do I want to get through today? Probably want to get through, I mean, what do I have? Probably want to get through 1, 2, 3, 4. Probably want to get through 5. So I'll get through one more here. That way I can do 5 tomorrow's, 5 for our next video. Since there's 10 total. 10 total if I do single pages, which I didn't do when I printed them off. I did them as double pages.75 questions total if you haven't looked at the packet yet. 75 questions total. So we'll get through this one, then I'll end the video here for our first video, review video. All right, so state of each scenario involves permutation combinations and find the number of possibilities. Oh, sorry. That was my answer key. Let's get back to the ride-on questions, the ones that were actually working. Just checking my answers with my key, making sure that I'm doing them right as we go along, as I usually do. All right, so write the slope-intercept form of the line through the point perpendicular to the given line. So perpendicularity means that the slope is the negative reciprocal. So my slope here, because this slope is negative 3/2, my slope from my line will be positive 2/3. It'll be the flip, the sign negated. And then my point is 3, 5, so I'm going to do the point slope form here first. Y minus the y value is equal to m 2/3 times the quantity x minus the x value, 3. I did ask for slope-intercept form, so I should distribute this 2/3 to the x minus 3 and then add the 5 over to the 3. So I should take that 2/3 to the x minus 3, so that becomes 2/3 x. And then 2/3 times negative 3, well, that's 6/3, so that's negative 2, and then plus 3, plus 5 is 3. So this will be 2/3 x plus 3. In terms of its finished answer, the answer you're going to have to match on the test. Because it did ask me for slope-intercept form, not point slope. So this involves distribution, the concept of distribution from Algebra 1. You distribute this to both items, and then you add this item over. All right, factoring questions. So here my goal is to get 72, the factors of 72 that make 18 when they add. So I'm looking at 72, and immediately my options that I'm thinking of using, and it might not be the right options, but my options I think of I'm using would be 9 and 8. Because 9 and 9 is 81, 9 and 8 is 72, but 9 plus 8 is only 17. So if this 18 was a 17, I would be using 9 and 8 there. But it's not. It's an 18. So then I'm thinking the other options here. 12 and 6 comes to mind next. And 12 and 6 do make 18 when they add together. 12 plus 6 is 18, and 12 times 6 is in value 72. So those are my proper values, x plus 12 and x plus 6. Proper factors. All right, next one, unit triangles. So with the unit triangles, it's x for this 30, 60, 90. The lengths here are related together. So this is our base length. This is double the base length, and this is the base length times root 3. So in other words, this is the base number here for to move from this to the short side or to the shorter leg, we divide by root 3. So y is equal to 4 root 3 divided by root 3. So y is equal to 4. And to move from the y, the short leg, to the longer leg, the hypotenuse, you double that. 8. So the relationship again is this is the base length, the hypotenuse is double the base length, and this length here is the base length times by the root 3, or times by the square root of 3. All right, the 45 triangle is isosceles. So if this is 5, this is also 5. Y is 5. Because these angles are the same, 45 and 45. And then the hypotenuse is 5, is the base length time, followed by the root 2. X is equal to 5 root 2. So when I'm looking at that again, that has the relationship x and x root 2, or the base length, and base length times by the square root of 2 for the hypotenuse. It's an isosceles right triangle. All right, next one, tangent. Tangent is equal to opposite over adjacent from the perspective of the angle provided. So from angle Z, the side that's opposite is 24. There's my opposite. And the side that's adjacent is this 32. 24 to 32, it does reduce, dividing by 8, becomes 3 to 4. The longest side here is the hypotenuse. That's why I didn't use the 40. I didn't use the 40 because I'm not using the hypotenuse for my tangent ratio. I'm using opposite and adjacent. Sine is opposite over hypotenuse, SOHCAHTOA. So again, I'm looking from this perspective angle Z. The side that's opposite is 28. And the hypotenuse is 35, the longest side. These are both multiples of 7. So I can divide by 7 here to get the reduced answer, which is 4/5. All right, next one, 35. 35 and 36, these do require a calculator. So if your teacher is not using a calculator, then they will have you skip these two. If your teacher is, which I am, then you'll do these two. So this ratio here is a sine ratio that relates to these two because it's opposite and hypotenuse. So the sine of this angle, we'll call it x, is equal to 30 over 39. To get the angle, I'm going to take the arc sine of 30 over 39. The arc sine will give an angle out, in other words, from a given side ratio. All right, so the arc sine of 30 divided by 39. Now I'm in radian mode here. My answers are going to be in degrees on the test. So before you take the test, I will reset the calculator in degree mode. 50.3 degrees, 15 and a third degrees. You don't have to understand the concept of radian versus degree mode as an algebra, as a geometry student. I am using these in Algebra 2 with radians. But we are talking only in degrees here. All right, question 36. This is a cosine ratio, adjacent hypotenuse. Sides are labeled their adjacent hypotenuse. So in other words, the cosine of 62 is equal to 10 over x. Because x is in the bottom here, to get the value of x, we're going to divide cosine of 62 into 10. So in other words, the x is going to multiply over, and the cosine 62 is going to divide into the 10. 10 divided by cosine 62 degrees. And this one's not an arc cosine question, because we're looking for a side length, not an angle value. 10 divided by the cosine of 62 is about 21. 21 and 3/10. Next one, area of a polygon, half the apothem times the perimeter is the area of any polygon. So 1/2 apothem times perimeter. Remember to multiply by the apothem and then the perimeter, not just the side length, but the perimeter. So this is half times 11. Half of 11 doesn't divide evenly, so I'm not going to actually do half the 11. I'm going to do half the 8 times by 8. Now, the perimeter is the side length times the number of sides. So I'm looking at this shape here. It's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 sides. So I'm going to have to multiply this by 9 to do this properly. It's a nonagon, in other words. So I'm going to take half of 8 is 4 times 11 times 9 to get my answer here, which is 396. I don't have units, so it's just square units. Again, half the apothem multiplied by the perimeter will be the area of any polygon, as we discussed previously in class. All right, trapezoids. The middle angle